Right, let's proceed with our discussion. And now we are looking at magnetic circuits. So you see that there is a very big similarity between magnetism and electricity. So in electric circuits, we talked about resistance, which was the main component which we are using to do any other calculations. And in magnetic circuits, we use what is called the reluctance. So in as much as resistance is the opposition to the flow of current through the material, reluctance is opposition to the setting up or establishment of flux in a material. Now, you remember, we said you can calculate resistance from R is called rho L over A, right? Where rho is the resistivity, L is the length of the material, and A is its cross-sectional area. Just like the same way, reluctance now will be equal to L over mu A. Remember, mu is the permeability. A will be the cross-sectional area of the magnetic circuit or magnetic component, and L is the length of the material. So you can calculate R from L over mu A. Now the difference between magnetic circuits and electric circuits is that in electric circuits we give you the value of the resistance. In magnetic circuits, the main thing is for you to calculate the value of the reluctance. So that's the difference. In magnetic circuits, you have to calculate the reluctance. And that will be the most taxing part of this study. The unit is ampere tens per Weber, right? That's the unit of reluctance. So in a magnetic circuit, magnetic flux density becomes equal to mu multiplied by the H, which is the permeability multiplied by the magnetizing force. That gives you the magnetic flux density. Remember, I said magnetic flux density is measured in Teslas, right? Now we also have Ohm's law for magnetic circuits, where flux becomes equal to the MMF over the reluctance. MMF, which is F over the reluctance, gives you the flux established in a material. Remember, there's a law of effect is equal to effect is called the cause over the opposition. So in this case, the effect is the flux which is established. The cause is the MMF and the opposition is the reluctance. So phi is called F over R, flux in Webers, F in ampere tens and reluctance in ampere tens per Weber. And there's also Ampere's law for magnetic circuits, which is just the same as Kirchhoff's law for electric circuits. It says the sum of MMF rises is equal to the sum of MMF drops in a closed loop. And MMF is given by NI, which is the number of tens times the current. And the drops are given by HL, which is the magnetizing force multiplied by the length. So you can see that this becomes equal to E in electric circuits, and this becomes equal to IR in your electric circuits. This is the drop, this is the cause, right? For example, this is a magnetic circuit made of iron, steel, and cobalt. Then, because these materials have different permeability, they definitely have different reluctances. And then we have a coil of N tens with a coil I, which is producing our MMF. So this will be our MMF. Right? And then we have a magnetic path which will give us the reluctance. Remember, I said the taxing part in magnetic circuits is the calculation of the reluctance. So for iron, you have to calculate its reluctance, but we also said it's the magnetizing force on that component times the length of that component. So in this case, it will be the H at AB times the length of AB. Then the H at BC times the length of BC, H at CA and the length of CA. This gives us the Ampere's secondary law for magnetic circuits. and the Ni will be our equivalence of EMF, and this will be our drop. So if you can evaluate H for the different portions, then you can, and also L for the different portions, then you should also be able to get the MMF drops in such a circuit. Then there's also Ampere's law on flux. Remember, in an electric circuit, we said current will branch at a junction or at a node. In like manner, flux also branches at a node. And we are saying the flux entering a junction should be equal to the flux leaving a junction, just the same way we deal with electric circuits. Let's take for an example where we want to convert that magnetic circuit first into a magnetic equivalent circuit. Then after that, we calculate the required quantities, right? So the question says, determine the current I required to establish a flux of 1.5 times 10 to the power of minus 4 webers in the section of the core indicated. The relative permeability of our material is 640 because it is sheet steel. This value is given in the question, so you don't have to look for around for it. We'll give you mu r for your calculations. Then we want to see then, how do you determine the current that is required, right? So the first thing that you have to do is to convert that physical magnetic circuit into an equivalent magnetic circuit that looks exactly like an electric circuit. So the first thing that we need would be our source of EMF, of MMF, which is F. And remember, I said this is equal to N, Ni. Then this whole part, we bunch it into a single reluctance. So if reluctance of EFAB, this section represented by that reluctance, then this center leg BE is also represented by a reluctance here. And this outer part, which is come from B, C, D to E, is also represented by a single reluctance, right? Then using R is called R over mu A, you calculate R, this, that, and that. Okay? You calculate that. Then after calculating those values, you then proceed with your magnetic circuit. Now, you get the reluctance of this portion and the reluctance of that portion. You combine the reluctances just the same way you combine your resistances so that you give an overall reluctance in that portion. Then after that, the two will be in series. You combine them again to have a single reluctance of the whole circuit. Then from Ohm's law, flux phi becomes called MMF over the reluctance, which is the RT. So you find the total flux coming through there, right? Just like the way you do current division, you also apply the same law to find phi one and phi two, right? But then because I is not given, you find these values in terms of the reluctances. Then you substitute in the formula to get your required current I to establish that flux. So what I want you to do now is go there, try to follow what I was saying, make your calculations. Then I think we'll pick a small portion where we'll discuss this week the example, which we will not record as usual. So just take a snapshot of this screen. Try to do the example, then we'll do it in a discussion, preferably I think at 2 o'clock. So just get prepared, tell the others, I will do the work examples for you at 2 o'clock, this work example, and I'll show you exactly how we'll go about these calculations. Then after that, Next week, since you are coming back, then we start on inductive transient circuits in our physical lectures. So take a snapshot or a screenshot of this question. Try to calculate as I have explained, then we'll talk about it in the discussion. So that makes it for today. We meet during the discussion and we see how the values are calculated. Bye for now.